This is a community-supported legal education channel. Find out how you can support our mission at the links in the description below.
So it looks like this is the Running Man dance. I guess it's just where you're like, you're pumping your fists forward and making your legs run in place. But you're doing like the smooth run in place, as opposed to like, you know, lifting your knees and all that. So that's what's at issue here in this case where Jalen Brantley and Jared Nickens sued Epic Games and Fortnite for appropriating their dance, The Running Man. They have sued for the alleged unauthorized appropriation of the dance, The Running Man, that they allegedly created, named, and popularized. I'm guessing it's that one. I don't know if it's 100% that one, but that's likely that one. Plaintiffs claim that Epic Games intentionally copied the movements of the Running Man dance and incorporated them as a feature of its highly popular online video game, Fortnite. Now, does any of this sound familiar? Because I remember being in the parking lot of a Tesco in the UK, in Scotland, back in December of 2018, talking about Fortnite dances, and was it not Mintley. Who was the guy? Millie. Millie Rocks was the guy who created the Millie Rock dance. And he lost his copyright case under these exact circumstances, I think. So how we are here over a year later on the exact same case, but brought by somebody else. Did they have an attorney? I guess let's pay attention and see if they had an attorney. They bring 8 causes of action under common law and the Lanham Act, which is trademark, and unfair competition, unjust enrichment, trademark infringement, trademark dilution, false designation of origin. Okay, so they didn't bring copyright, which is why we're not here on copyright. Okay. Epic Games moves to dismiss the claims, and the claims are dismissed with prejudice. Plaintiffs Brantley and Nickens allege that in 2016, they created, named, and popularized the dance move, which they titled The Running Man. Now, wait a second here. I'm 40 years old. I've done The Running Man, or my woefully inadequate interpretation of it, way before 2016. I mean, like, basically every party I've ever been to, like a wedding reception or somebody's graduation or a, you know, 10-year high school reunion or something, which I don't think I attended anyway. I think I attended my 10. I didn't attend my 20. You know, people dance and you do fun dances, and one of them is The Running Man, or looks an awful lot like The Running Man. Let's take a short look at this dance here. Ha. Yeah. Ha. Okay. Yeah, that's The Running Man that everybody knows. And that was The Running Man way before 2016. I'm sorry. Maybe they did. I'm not a dancer. Maybe they know something I don't. Brantley and Nickens allege that they incorporated the dance into breaks at the University of Maryland basketball games, and the dance subsequently went viral on social media. So I can see how they feel they have a claim. Like, they think they started something. Sure. I brought the dancing tubas from the University of Delaware back to my high school, but that doesn't mean that they're committing copyright infringement when they do the dances that the tubas at the University of Delaware did, but back at Saucon Valley High School. Plaintiffs claim to have incited the online popularity of The Running Man by challenging others to imitate the dance and post the performance on social media. So Fortnite apparently asked people to imitate the dance. They state, plaintiffs, that the Running Man videos have over 100 million views on YouTube and thousands of people have posted videos of themselves performing the dance. The popularity of the Running Man challenge allegedly exploded in part after live performances of the dance by Brantley and Nickens on The Ellen Show. While plaintiffs repeatedly allege in their complaint that they created the dance during the Ellen segment, two high school students from New Jersey, Kevin Vincent and Jeremiah Hall, are credited with creating the dance instead. Brantley and Nickens appear later in the segment and state that they copied the dance from a video they saw on Instagram. Nonetheless, Brantley and Nickens claim that The Running Man has become synonymous with them. Okay, so that's why they're doing trademark instead of copyright. They're doing secondary meaning. They're saying that the dance has become so attached to their brand, to their sales, and their brand image that they have a trademark. So far, now here's something little known about trademark. I know this is really reaching. We never talk about this. Trademark is for branding in commerce, selling things. So let's pay attention. What are Brantley and Nickens selling that this dance is the brand or branding for? Defendant Epic Games is the creator and developer of Fortnite. Fortnite is a free-to-play online video game, etc. Brantley and Nickens allege that Epic Games created the Fortnite emote of the Running Man dance by impermissibly copying the movements of the Running Man dance and profiting from the sale. That's copyright. We'll see. Brantley and Nickens bring a total of 8 causes of action against Epic Games, as we saw. We're on a motion to dismiss standard of review. Epic Games argues that the Copyright Act preempts Brantley and Nickens' claims for invasion of the right of privacy and publicity for the common law unfair competition claim and the unjust enrichment claim. So now this is what we would call preemption. This is a really cool legal doctrine. Basically, they've tried to get around the law, is what Epic Games is saying. Tried to get around the law of copyright by claiming invasion of privacy, unfair competition, and unjust enrichment, when really what they're alleging is copying of constituent elements of an original work. It's preempted by the Copyright Act. The Copyright Act is a federal law that covers all this, so it really should be that, Your Honor. Similarly, Epic Games argues that Brantley and Nickens' claims for unfair competition and false designation of origin under the Trademark Act are also precluded by copyright. Finally, Epic argues that plaintiffs failed to plausibly allege a valid trademark claim. The court agrees with all of that. Just all of it. I agree with all of it. Plaintiffs' common law, privacy, unfair competition, and unjust enrichment claims are preempted by the Copyright Act. The Copyright Act expressly preempts a broad array of other claims. Here's a section we don't use often, section 301. All legal or equitable rights that are equivalent to any of the exclusive rights within the general scope of copyright as specified by the law that are fixed, so works of authorship that are fixed in a tangible medium expression, etc., whether created before or after the date, or whether published or unpublished, are governed exclusively by this title. So that means things that smack of copyright are copyright and are governed by the Copyright Act. Thereafter, no person is entitled to any such right or equivalent right in any such work under the common law or statutes of any state. This statutory language establishes a two-pronged test for determining copyright preemption. First, the work must be within the scope of the subject matter of copyright. And second, the rights granted under state law must be equivalent. The Running Man is within the subject matter of copyright, says the judge. Under the first prong of the test for copyright preemption, I must consider whether the work in question, the Running Man dance, falls within the subject matter of copyright. As relevant here, Section 102A provides that copyright protection subsists in accordance with this title in original works of authorship fixed in a tangible medium of expression, now known or later developed, from which they can be perceived, reproduced, or otherwise communicated. So the works can be communicated, either directly or with the aid of a machine or device. Works of authorship include the following categories, which include choreographic works. Section 102B provides that in no case does copyright protection for an original work of authorship extend to any idea, procedure, process, system, method, concept, principle, discovery, regardless of the form in which it is described, explained, illustrated, or embodied in such work. In other words, copyright protection extends to original works of authorship in a tangible medium, including choreographic works, but not for any ideas embodied in the work. So ideas are not protected, but expression is. The scope of copyright preemption is broader than the scope of copyright protection. That's an interesting one. We haven't seen that before. as long as the work fits within one of the general subject matter categories of copyright, the bill prevents the states from protecting it even if it fails to achieve federal statutory copyright because it is too minimal or lacking in originality to qualify. So in other words, federal government has the exclusive purview or control of copyright. The analysis under this first prong of the test for copyright preemption is the same for Brantley and Nickens' invasion of the right of privacy or publicity, common law unfair competition, and unjust enrichment claims, because they are all based on the alleged copying and use of the Running Man dance. Plaintiffs argue that they allege that the Running Man is a dance and not a choreographic work, and therefore is not the subject of copyright. So in other words, can we get around copyright because we know that dances aren't copyrightable? Therefore, can this claim be preempted by copyright because it's only a mere dance? Can you have trademark and all that other protection based on a mere dance, and it only works because it's a mere dance and not a choreographic work? The U.S. Copyright Office has published a compendium of U.S. copyright practices that provides an explanation of how it considers the distinction between a choreographic work and a dance, which provides a useful guide. The office defines choreography as the composition and arrangement of a related series of dance movements in patterns organized into a coherent whole. By definition, choreography is a subset of dance. As such, a work of authorship cannot be registered as a choreographic work unless it is comprised of dance steps, dance movements, or dance patterns. However, the term choreography is not synonymous with dance. The legislative history for the Copyright Act clearly states that choreographic works do not include social dance steps and simple routines. The U.S. Copyright Office states that choreographic works typically contain one or more of the following elements: rhythmic movements in a defined space, compositional arrangement, music or textual accompaniment, dramatic content, presentation before an audience, and execution by skilled performers. Choreographic works are distinguished from de minimis movements, dance steps, social dances, and simple routines, which are not copyrightable. Individual movements or dance steps themselves are not copyrightable, such as the basic waltz, the hustle, the grapevine, or the second position in a classical ballet. Thus, the dividing line between copyrightable choreography and uncopyrightable dance is a continuum rather than a bright line. At one extreme are ballets, modern dances, and other complex works that represent a related series of dance movements in patterns organized into a coherent compositional whole. At the other extreme are social dances, simple routines, and uncopyrightable movements. Many works fall somewhere in between. In a similar case, Pellegrino v. Epic Games. I'm guessing this was one from last year. This one says March 31st, 2020, so I guess maybe not. The United States District Court for Pennsylvania, Eastern District, recently analyzed this distinction between choreography and dance for the purposes of copyright preemption regarding another Fortnite emote. In that case, Leo Pellegrino, a professional saxophone player, alleged that Epic Games copied his signature dance movement involving turning his legs and feet to the side while playing the saxophone to create the phone it in emote for the Fortnite game. Like here, Pellegrino brought claims for violation of the rights of privacy, of publicity, unjust enrichment, unfair competition, trademark infringement, and dilution, but no copyright claim since that had been previously dismissed. The court dismissed his state law trademark infringement claim after finding that it was preempted by the Copyright Act. In reaching this conclusion, the court looked to the Copyright Act's compendium and held that Pellegrino's signature move was a dance within the subject matter of copyright under the first prong of the copyright preemption test. At issue, therefore, is whether the dance falls within the subject matter of copyright. We conclude that it does. Specifically, we find that dance falls within the ambit of the copyright category choreographic works. Although the term choreography is not synonymous with dance, a work of authorship cannot be registered as a choreographic work unless it is comprised of dance steps. Whether the Running Man dance could be subject to copyright protection is a closer question. It has some characteristics of a choreographic work. It consists of rhythmic movements in a defined space, has music accompaniment, and was presented before an audience. However, it could also be compared to a dance step, like the basic waltz step, the hustle, the grapevine, or the second position of the classical ballet, and therefore would not be copyrightable. the running man also potentially could be characterized as a social dance, given that it was widely enjoyed and performed by thousands of members in the public. In short, Running Man is somewhere on the continuum between copyrightable choreography and uncopyrightable dance. Fortunately, the question of precisely where on that continuum it falls does not need to be decided. Given the scope of copyright preemption is broader than that of copyright protection, it is sufficient here to find that the Running Man dance is well within the general subject matter of copyright under a choreographic work. Therefore, like the court in Pellegrino, I find that the Running Man dance is well within the subject matter of copyright law, satisfying the first prong of the test for copyright preemption. Under the second prong of the copyright preemption test, the rights to be preempted must be equivalent to the rights protected by the Copyright Act. Section 106 is the copyrights, the right to prepare copies, to prepare derivatives, to distribute copies, to perform or display the copyrighted work. Under the test provided in the Burge case, a claim avoids preemption when it contains an extra element that changes the nature of the action so that it is qualitatively different from a copyright infringement claim. Courts in this circuit have repeatedly found that claims based on alleged misappropriation protect the same exclusive rights under the Copyright Act. These cases are instructive. In the Progressive case, a Fourth Circuit court upheld the district court's dismissal of Progressive's state law unfair competition and tortious interference claims based on copyright preemption. In that case, Progressive alleged that Intigon, the defendant, had copied one of its insurance manuals that contained its method for determining which insurance risks to accept and at what price. So, like actuarial tables, I guess. The Fourth Circuit observed that courts have consistently held that unfair competition claims based on misappropriation protect the same rights as Congress sought to protect by the Copyright Act and are therefore preempted. The Fourth Circuit found that the misappropriation claim was part and parcel of the copyright claim and was therefore preempted. Likewise, the Fourth Circuit found the claim for tortious interference with business relations was preempted, notwithstanding that Progressive had pled the four elements of the tort or the claim, which differ from those of a copyright claim. The key was that although those specific elements of the tort differed, they were still based on the same alleged conduct that was within the scope of copyright protection. The Lowry court or case involved a claim for unjust enrichment based on Legg Mason's use of Lowry's proprietary stock market reports. Legg Mason paid for one subscription, but then disseminated the information to its brokers around the country. On a summary judgment record, the district court held that the Copyright Act preempted Lowry's unjust enrichment claim. Although Lowry characterized its unfair competition claim as a hot news claim and argued that this type of claim contains extra elements not found in copyright, the court found that none of those elements it posits of such a claim describes behavior other than reproduction, performance, distribution, or display. Accordingly, the court held that the unfair conduct of which Lowry complains does not differ qualitatively from conduct which would infringe on one of the exclusive rights granted by the Copyright Act and was therefore preempted. Like those cases, Brantley and Nickens bring common law claims based on alleged unauthorized copying of The Running Man, and these claims are therefore preempted by the Copyright Act. So first, they bring an invasion of the right of privacy or publicity claim. They do not elaborate on the distinction between this and the other state laws. They allege that Epic Games misappropriated their identities by capturing and copying their signature movement, The Running Man, to create the movement that allows the player's avatars to execute The Running Man identically. Brantley and Nickens further allege that Epic did not obtain their consent or authorization and is therefore willfully and intentionally using their likenesses. Plaintiffs argue that their claim based on misappropriation of their identities and likenesses contains extra elements that preclude preemption, citing a Maryland case and a Third Circuit case, etc. One of the cases they cite did not involve preemption. Even though the rights of publicity claims are not preempted in some cases, that does not mean that they avoid preemption in every case. Here, plaintiff's claim is based on Epic Games allegedly capturing and digitally copying the Running Man dance to create the Fortnite emote that allows the player's avatars to execute the Running Man identically to plaintiff's version. This is squarely within the rights protected by the Copyright Act At best, plaintiffs add the conclusory allegation that the running man dance is their likeness, but even granting inferences in favor of plaintiffs, the court is not obligated to adopt legal conclusions devoid of further factual enhancement. See Ashcroft v. Iqbal, a basic jurisdiction case. Therefore, because the rights that plaintiffs seek to vindicate in their right of publicity claim are equivalent to those of the Copyright Act, namely in the reproduction, performance, distribution, and display, the claim is preempted and dismissed. So they do unfair competition. I'm going to start skipping a little bit. So unfair competition, the gravamen of both types of claims are the misappropriation of the original work. Unjust enrichment is next. This claim is based on alleged misappropriation. So what would unjust enrichment be? You had some sort of contractual relationship with someone and you benefited from that relationship in a way you weren't supposed to. You were unjustly enriched by that relationship or that agreement or that performance or whatever. That's misappropriation. Yeah, that's going to be preempted by copyright too. Then they have trademark claims. Unfair competition under trademark, trademark infringement, trademark dilution, and false designation of origin. The Lanham Act section provides any person who, in connection with any goods or services, uses in commerce any word, term, name, similar device, so a mark, or any combination or false designation of origin or false or misleading description or false or misleading representation, which is likely to cause confusion, is guilty of trademark infringement. Plaintiffs' Lanham Act unfair competition claims, etc., are dismissed because the allegations are properly the subject of copyright. The Lanham Act claims are dismissed because plaintiffs fail to allege a trademark. Plaintiff's common law trademark claim fails for the same reason. So they are preempted by copyright, but they also fail to establish or allege a trademark. They literally haven't used them in commerce. Copyrights do not expressly preempt the Lanham Act or as another federal statute, but the Supreme Court discussed the delineation between the lines of trademark claims and copyright claims in Daystar Corporation. The court explained that the origin of goods provision of the Lanham Act was designed to prevent consumer confusion as to the source of goods and not originality or creativity, which is copyright or patent. The court held that the phrase origin of goods refers only to the producer of the tangible goods that are offered for sale and not to the author of an idea, concept, or communication. Daystar therefore instructs the causes of action under the Lanham Act or Trademark Act based on misappropriation and confusion that they can proceed only where there's confusion as to the producer of the product sold in the marketplace and not the person or entity that originated the idea. Plaintiffs do not allege facts that suggest there is confusion regarding the producer of a tangible product sold in a marketplace. At best, the allegations indicate that each plaintiff might be a person or entity that originated the idea or communication of a good or services, but this fails to establish a trademark claim. Therefore, these claims are dismissed. And then they're going to do the same thing with the trademark infringement and dilution claims. Trademarks themselves are not the goods or services. So the running man dance would have to be the designator of the origin of goods or services. So in other words, like a Coca-Cola bottle, you look at a Coca-Cola bottle, you're not buying the bottle for the bottle in most cases, you're buying it for the product that's inside. And specifically, you're buying for the specific product inside made by Coca-Cola, and you only think that it's made by Coca-Cola because it's in the right bottle on the store shelf. Because it's in the correct bottle with the correct branding is really the only reason that you know that that is a genuine bottle of Coke and not some counterfeit. And you could be fooled very easily. And if you can be fooled, the way that you got fooled, that's considered trademark infringement because there was actual confusion in the marketplace. What is the product that is being sold by the Running Man dance? Plaintiffs allege that their trademark is the Running Man and that has become distinct and immediately recognizable. The trademark is allegedly based on plaintiff's likeness. To the extent that this is more than a conclusory allegation, as a general rule, Images and likenesses do not function as trademarks. Moreover, Brantley and Nickens have not adequately alleged how the Running Man dance is used to identify a unique good or service. In their brief in opposition, Brantley and Nickens argue that the Running Man dance is a trademark for performances by plaintiffs. This argument is too clever by half. The Running Man dance cannot be a trademark for performances of the Running Man dance. What did I just say? Therefore, Brantley and Nickens' Lanham Act trademark infringement and trademark dilution and common law trademark infringement claims are dismissed for failure to allege a trademark. Finally, plaintiffs allege, as part of their Lanham Act unfair competition and trademark infringement claims, that defendants have created the false impression that plaintiff endorsed Fortnite. Although plaintiffs did not plead this as a separate cause of action, I will address it. In an action for false endorsement, the plaintiff must prove that likelihood of consumer confusion as to the origin, approval, or endorsement of the product is likely. Several other courts have dismissed false endorsement claims on the basis of Daystar. For example, in Rudolphsky versus Western Washington Publishers Corp, Publishing Corp, Western, I guess, I don't know. I don't remember what the W abbreviation is. The court held, I have a blue book right here I could look it up in, but it's sealed up for technical. The court held that claims under the Trademark Act for false endorsement were precluded by Daystar. In that case, plaintiffs were two law professors who sued West Publishing, so it was West Publishing Company, after it published, I'm assuming that's Thomson Reuters West, published a supplement to a treatise authored by the plaintiffs without their knowledge and without their names listed as authors. The Rudolphsky court explained that allowing a false endorsement claim would lead to the very conflict between the trademark and the Copyright Act that the Supreme Court was seeking to avoid in Daystar. Quote, to accord special treatment to communicative products, that is, to read the word origin in the Lanham Act to cover the authors of communicative products, would cause the Lanham Act to conflict with the law of copyright, which addresses that subject specifically. The court held that another practical difficulty of adopting a special definition of origin for communicative products is that it places the manufacturers of those products in a difficult position. On one hand, they would face Lanham Act trademark liability for failing to credit the author or the creator of a work on which their lawful copies are based. On the other hand, they could face a Lanham Act liability act claim for crediting the creator if that should be regarded as implying the creator's sponsorship or approval. The defendants here would be placed in precisely this position if the Lanham Act claims, particularly the false endorsement claim, were permitted to go forward. In other words, while Daystar dealt with an unfair competition claim under the Lanham Act, the same principles apply to claims for false endorsement. In Pellegrino, the court declined to dismiss a claim for false endorsement, finding that such claims were not necessarily barred by Daystar. In that case, the court distinguished the case we just went over, and found that plaintiff's allegations that Epic Games used his likeness did not depend on the authorship or origin of his signature move, and therefore stated a distinct claim for false endorsement. Even if allegations in that case supported such a distinction here, they do not. Plaintiff's allegations regarding false endorsement are based on copying the Running Man dance and the conclusory allegation that Epic Games used their likeness. A false endorsement claim based on these allegations would lead to the type of conflict between the Trademark Act and the Copyright Act that the Supreme Court sought to avoid in Daystar. Therefore, plaintiffs' Lanham Act claims are dismissed. For the reasons stated above, all of plaintiffs' claims are dismissed. The dismissal is with prejudice. Plaintiffs were given an opportunity to amend and they did so, therefore further amendment would be futile. Plaintiffs seek to place the same square peg into eight round holes in search of a cause of action against Epic Games for its use of the Running Man dance in Fortnite. But plaintiffs' claims that Epic Games copied the dance do not support any of their theories. Plaintiffs' common law causes of action for invasion of the right of publicity or privacy, unfair competition, and unjust enrichment are dismissed based on preemption under the Copyright Act. Similarly, their claims of unfair competition and false designation of origin are dismissed because their allegations are in the domain of copyright law and not the Lanham Act for trademark. Finally, plaintiffs' remaining trademark claims are dismissed for failure to plausibly allege a valid trademark because plaintiffs already amended their complaint once. In light of these deficiencies, further amendment would be futile. Plaintiff's claims are dismissed with prejudice. The clerk is directed to close this case. That is Judge Paul W. Grimm, United States District Judge for the District of Maryland, of all places. So yeah, you can't copyright dance moves for the last time, and trying to do a end run around the court by converting all of your claims to trademark claims and common law claims so you don't have to allege a copyright claim that the court will never notice. The court noticed. So that is our show. Thank you for joining me, everyone. I'm Leonard French, your favorite copyright attorney, and this is Lawful Masses, your favorite community-supported legal news and education channel. Community-supported means we need your financial support in order to keep this effort going and keep making you new videos on modern or contemporary legal news and education. Thank you to the following June $50 plus supporters: Joe Tyson, Wes Delj, Citizen of the Sovereign, John Steele, Gavin Barnard, Eevi, Kyle Mudrak, Spirit Bear, Jan Negrey, Michael Pearce, Daniel Perez, Blackleaf, Benjamin Hitov, Steven, Ottah, Cute Grills in Your Area, Longreach Jones, Definitely Not Prenda Law, Ugly Grill, Shielo T, Josh Baker, Gregory, Rudolph Bescherer Jr., Kristian Hellman, Jay Dixon, Ameknight, and Oscar the Prophet. Thank you so much for your support. Thank you to the $5 plus supporters who are scrolling on the LED panel next to me. All of you will appear on the crawls in front of me and in the video, in the description of the videos that drop. I'm Leonard French. I love you all. I honestly can't believe, do you remember the end of My Cousin Vinny when Marissa Tomei turns to Joe Pesci and says, "What a nightmare. At the end of everything you do, after winning every court case for your entire career, you have to turn to somebody and you have to say, thank you." You know what? Thank you. You guys are wonderful. This is an amazing community, and I'm so happy to be a part of it. I'm Leonard French. I love you all. I'll see you in the videos that drop. Thank you.